isn't that also the theme music for Impromptu?
It is the theme music. Yeah.
This is a lovely film.
The movie starring Hugh Grant. Yes.
Deborah Winger. Now, Frédéric François Chopin lived for a very brief period of time, just 39 years,
yes.
From 1810 to 1849. I mean, he was one of the world's greatest composers, and he composed music for the piano.
Almost exclusively for the piano, unlike most other composers like Mozart or Beethoven, who composed not just piano pieces, but also for the orchestra and for choirs and for motets and so on. Chopin was called the poet for the piano, and because he exclusively composed for the piano, and he made this instrument his own. And there is nothing that Chopin has done, there's nothing that he's left unexplored on the piano, in not just in terms of formats, but also in terms of how he's used the keys, how he's used the scales and so on. It's just absolutely sensational.
Now, I was doing a bit of research, and I read that he concentrated more on expressive depth, emotional depth, yeah, than virtuosity.
And he brought a lot of lyricism to pianistic playing. So, for instance, still then, a Mozart piece would be very structured and just go. Very beautiful, but very structured. Mm-hmm. Chopin took all these things to a different level. He started putting in certain passages, flourishes, and phraseologies, which make the music come alive in terms of expressiveness. So, in like Carnatic music, we have things like padams, mm-hmm. which are a lot more about human emotion and looking at the complexity of human emotion, because Chopin himself went through a very complex life. And so, he brings all of that to the piano. So, for instance, even in the piece that I played, he has juxtaposed a simple four beat. So four beat is 1, 2, 3, 4. 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. That's what's going on the left hand. Faster. Except that Mozart would have done and stuck to the four. But what Chopin does is he puts a six beat in the right hand, juxtaposes them on a four beat. So it becomes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And he does. And he does that.
Virtuosity also.
Completely. And to play Chopin requires the highest level of piano skills. But what is fantastic about it is that, so he has innovated on structure, he's innovated on emotion, he's innovated on formats. Chopin, in fact, created formats like the etudes and the nocturnes. Nocturnes were actually created by another composer called John Field. And these are meant to be played as chamber pieces. In fact, what I credit Chopin the most with is having taken chamber music and the two just solo piano chamber music to a great high. He created a format, for instance, called the nocturne, which is a piece to be played in the evening. And it was typically played as a salon piece, you know, where you have a lot of people gathering in the evening into a room.
And he did a lot of concerts like that,
like
very
that,
private,
yes,
gatherings.
And therefore, the pianist had to be a virtuoso, because otherwise how do you hold people's attention for such a long time? And his technical wizardry on the piano, even as a piano player, was very legendary in that time.
So can we listen to a nocturne?
I'll play a nocturne, which is the first nocturne in B flat minor.
Gosh, you need to be so ambidextrous, isn't it? When we come back after a short break, Anil will play us a snatch from a prelude and a bit of a mazurka as well. Stay tuned.
Hindustani or Carnatic music, that means going from the panchamam to the shadjamam. So it always ends, whatever, if you look at a piece by Mozart,